Hey, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Indy Investor Pod. I am excited to have Ryan Boyd join me here today. And Ryan's a guy, I feel like I see him all over the place. People are talking about him all over the place. And it's just like, man, this guy's just doing some awesome stuff here within Indy real estate and Indy real estate investing. So, Ryan, thanks a lot for joining me, man.
Thanks for having me, Brian. It's a pleasure.
Yeah. So let's just kind of get into this a little bit for maybe those people that don't know you or haven't heard of you or don't see all the properties you're just like, you know, posting all over Facebook and stuff. So let's hear a little bit of just kind of your background, kind of what you were doing, how you got into real estate and kind of what you're doing today, man.
Yeah, absolutely. So before I got into real estate, I actually did music full time for about 12 years with my brothers. We had a little brother band thing going on, and it was really cool. But unfortunately, the band does not make as much money as everyone's led on to believe. So yeah, we didn't see much of a future in that. I hadn't gone to college at that point. And so I saw some people that I thought I was maybe a little smarter than killing it in real estate. And I thought, if those idiots could do it, there's of course I can do it. So
awesome. I got to ask you.
I found out quickly. They're fast. They're a lot smarter than me, I found out.
I do have to ask just before we keep going is like, what kind of music were you guys doing?
Yeah, we had a pop punk kind of thing going on. So we just played typical, like kind of just your pop rock stuff you'd hear on the radio. We ended up opening up for cool artists like the Jonas Brothers. We opened for Keith Urban, Chris Allen, a couple artists back then. So yeah, it was really fun. Wouldn't take it back for anything. Traveling was amazing, but yeah, different stage of life now. So
that's awesome, man. That's awesome.
Yeah. So we went from there. I got into real estate about 3 years ago. I joined at a brokerage called Platt Collective, which was a pretty new brokerage at the time. Pretty known for the downtown Indy market. So I've been doing that for the last 3 years, and it has been a dream ever since. Yeah, I got really into investing. Before I got into being a realtor, I did buy my first investment property with an agent, the duplex in Garfield Park. And from there, I just, yeah, had to keep going. It was really fun.
That's great. So I know actually like today's a great city. I don't know actually what day this will like come out and stuff. Today's just a nice day in the city. The sun's shining. It's perfect. And even though it's wintertime, and I was just like, and I got to get out and just drive the city. That's what I was doing for like 3 hours this morning. And all of a sudden I see, oh, there's a Platt Collective sign. There's a Platt Collective sign and stuff like that. So no, very cool. So I got to ask though, like kind of what, as you got into it, I know like you kind of picked up an investment property and stuff and kind of got into it that way. But what made you, I feel like you do a great job of standing out for like, hey, if I'm an investor in Indy, like, you know, Ryan's an agent that you can go to and talk to. I know we have Glory on our team that handles that. And I feel like, so you guys have kind of like set yourself out as like kind of the go-to agents, I feel like, along with some others for investors. Like, how did you decide? Did that just kind of happen? Or like, how'd you come to that? Like, hey, I'm going to be, yeah, I like this investor side versus that kind of more of the retail side kind of thing.
Yeah. Well, I have a split clientele. I would say probably about 70% of my clients are out-of-state investors. Mm-hmm. A lot of them I've never met. A lot of them will never walk through the property that they buy. And honestly, most relationships come down to trust more times than not. It's our job as agents to always look out for our client's best interest. And once that trust is established, it really goes very well. I mean, if I do a good job for you on one property, it's likely you're probably going to buy another one or tell somebody else about me. So it doesn't make sense for me to make a quick dollar, kind of sell you on a house that's not really that good. I found that being your client's advocate and looking out for their best interests at all times is always the best route to go. And that's really how I've been able to develop the business that I have. So it's been really exciting.
Yeah, that's great. I think it's really good advice for just investors out here that might be listening to that. And that's what I always like to tell people too. Like I can sell you one property. That's really easy to do. My goal is not that. And my goal is really to sell you 10 or 100, whatever your goal is. And those are the people when you're out there looking for, whether it's an agent, whether it's a wholesaler or just some source to send you properties, find that person that's what they're interested in, of getting you to your goals. They're asking you questions about that, not just like, hey, here's a property, will you buy it, that kind of thing. So I think that's great advice, man. Let's talk a little bit about just the Indy market in general, as it's, you know, I was just on a call with some people from Phoenix and their market's just incredible. It's blowing up. But I feel like just every market's like that right now. Just inventory is kind of low across the board. People know it, people can feel it, but you know, just the Indy market, how are you feeling about it? Where do you, like when people call up and say like, hey, how do you feel about the Indy market right now? What's something that you would just tell them about that?
Absolutely. Well, Indy's definitely been consistent when it comes to population growth. over the next 10 years, we expect about a 300,000 population increase for people moving to Indy. And a majority of that's going to be in the metro area. So your Indianapolis, your bigger markets, your Fort Wayne, Fishers, all of those different areas. So that's one thing that's really helpful. When the population's on the up, that's always going to be helpful, especially as a rental investor. You want to see the population going up, not down. That's a big thing. And then a diverse market. I don't want to, you know, call it other cities, but we don't have one company that we solely rely on. So we have a whole bunch of different companies that are moving here to Indy. Quite a bit of the tech scene starting to check out Indy as well. So we have a really diverse market. And I think that's been very, very helpful for our economy and the continual growth that we've seen over the last at least 10 years.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And I think that's a huge thing right there. And I'm glad you said that. And like looking at the numbers and looking at the data, this is data from like before COVID, like, and it's still kind of consistent along with that before COVID and stuff. But like, if you look at the job market in Indianapolis right now, there's still like jobs being posted. It was at like 2 jobs for every house being built. Right now it's like at 1.5 jobs for every house being built. Like, that's incredible considering I feel like there's just houses that are being built all over the place right now. And knowing that there's basically that many jobs still out there available here in Indianapolis is great. And it is for reasons that the affordability, it comes into the housing market, but it also comes into just the business market in general. There are people, businesses from, you know, California, from New York, from Texas that are moving here because it's a lot more affordable to operate a business out of Indiana. So job market's great. Housing market's going to be great because of that. And that rental market is also going to be great because of that, because you're going to have people coming in here. So yeah, man.
Exactly.
Good stuff. So we talked a little bit about how you're working with agents. A lot of that is kind of, you know, just, you know, word of mouth and, you know, trusting. And I think you do a great job of that. Is one of the things I want to dig in with you and just talk about a little bit is when you sit down or have that, you know, first Zoom call or that first phone call with your investor. I like that you threw in there too, that like, I haven't met most of them and stuff. I love deals.
It's
like
true.
That. Like, it's great. It's great. So those are some of my favorite things. But like when you have that first maybe phone call or just a, you know, Zoom call with them or whatever, I want to talk about for those investors that are looking to start working with an agent, whether it's you or somebody else, what are some questions that they could be asking that agent? What are some things that they should be asking that agent, I should say?
Yeah. Well, I think especially the market that you're trying to target. So if you're trying to target downtown Indianapolis, you want to make sure that your agent is familiar with that market. I live in Indianapolis. I can help buy and sell real estate all over the state because I grew up here. But when it comes down to the specific market, you definitely want to have an agent that's really knowledgeable. So if you're talking Indianapolis, you've probably heard this a lot on the podcast, it's very street by street. And you have to know the neighborhoods because South Fountain Square and North Fountain and regular Fountain Square have very, very different values. And it's very important to have somebody that understands the difference. Also, there are sometimes certain streets that normally a house that would sell for $200,000 on the street just south of it could sell for half of that. So I think it's really important to have boots on the ground that really knows the neighborhoods that you're looking into. And I think once you develop the trust with that agent, that's going to be where you really hit the ground running because you can develop systems, processes, and really just make every transaction easier as you go. It gets easier and easier to the point where sometimes I don't even have to see the house in person because my clients trust the contractors that are going through it to provide the quote. So it's really cool once you kind of get everything set together.
Yeah, that's great. Let's kind of go on the opposite end of that. Then too, is like, you know, I asked about like, what are some things that maybe investors should be asking you? What are some things that maybe that you're asking investors that they should be able to answer? I know a lot of times when I'm working with a new buyer and stuff, I'll throw out a question like, well, what's your price point? Oh, I don't know. You tell me. And you know, I get some answers like that and stuff. Like, no, I need you to figure that out. I need you to let me know. Let's talk through that together. But what are some of those things that maybe investors don't necessarily think about that maybe you're asking that they do need to think about, or you need to give them time to think about on the back end?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think a lot of times it can be difficult for me to help you understand what you are looking for. A lot of times they'll have very, I don't want to say aimless, but maybe not exactly sure the direction they're trying to go when it comes to buying real estate. So they'll say, I want to buy anywhere from an A-class neighborhood to a D-class neighborhood. Well, that doesn't help me a lot because that could mean pretty much all of Indiana. Yeah. So I think if you can really figure out your criteria, I mean, some people really narrow it down to, I'm looking for a 3-bedroom, 1-bathroom, 1,000 square feet, you know, a house that's older than, as old as 1950. The more that you can do that, the easier it is for us to really hone in on the criteria you're looking for. So that's a huge thing, is just really understand what it is that you want and what you feel comfortable doing. But then also you want to be flexible because our market's a little tight. So you need to have, you know, some variations within that criteria. So yeah, that's always really helpful. Figure out, are you buying this in cash? Are you using financing? You know, are you going to use your bank from your city that's, you know, 1,000 miles away, or do you trust a local bank that is going to be probably better able to service you for the local market? That's always a huge thing for me, because if you're using a bank from a different state, from a different city, a lot of times sellers get a little bit scared of that because they'll pull appraisers from, you know, counties that are three counties over that don't know what's going on in Indianapolis or what's going on in Fishers or Noblesville, you know, so it's really important to have a local lender, in my opinion. It's really helpful.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I want to kind of go back to, you know, something you said of that Indy is very like street by street, and we all know that, and we've all talked about that. We've all heard that and stuff. So what are some things that maybe an investor can do to help educate themselves on that, other than, you know, you work with a lot of out of state investors too, especially when it's like, hey, I can maybe come out once or twice a year and I can drive around and stuff like that. But what are some things that maybe investors can do to help educate themselves on that? Or is it just like, no, Ryan, that's why I'm paying you commission. Like, you can figure that out and let me know how that works and stuff.
Well, it's a combination of a lot of things. Anybody that invests from out of state, please, please come to Indiana, because it's so helpful, especially if you're investing in Indianapolis. If you're investing in Fishers or, you know, suburban market, it's a lot more straightforward because a lot of the houses were built all the same time. Downtown, you can have a house built from 1890 all the way up to 2020 on the same street. So it's really helpful for you to get your eyes on the city that you're investing in. Please do that. Number one. Number two, join different groups on Facebook. Get involved in the Bigger Pockets community, or get involved in the Indianapolis Out of State Investors group on Facebook. Anything like that is going to be so helpful. And find some friends that invest in these markets, because I won't be able to answer every single question that you have all of the time. So I really recommend get people around you, find people that you look up to a lot that are killing it in the Indianapolis or suburban markets, and really just talk to them as much as you can, and make sure you're adding value to them. You don't want to be taking all the time. It's really helpful if you're able to provide value to them by, you know, analyzing deals or giving them rental comps. Anything like you can provide value-wise is so helpful, especially for experienced investors.
Yeah. That's one of the things I love about the Indy market too, in general. I feel like there's a really good investor community here in Indianapolis, where they are willing to help each other out. They're going to give us some honest feedback. Whether it's local people, out of state people, you know, agents, wholesale, whoever, like, I feel like there is a really good community, and vet some people too. If there's somebody that you haven't heard of or you haven't worked with before, just ask around. And I think it's really easy. You'll get a feel for, you know, somebody that's maybe done a deal with them or got burned on a deal with them or just hasn't heard of them. That says something in itself too. So ask around. I think it's a really good community, really supportive community. So with this community, it is a great community, but it's also a competitive community, a competitive market right now. So what are some tips on just like when you do have a market that is this competitive, and I'm sure everybody's dealing with this right now, of like, man, how do I stand out for myself as an investor? How do I stand out with my offers? What are some tips or some things that you maybe have on that front of just like, man, how do I get in front of the deals before anybody else? Or how can I put in an offer that I know it's going to be competitive, but I'm not overpaying? What's your advice for that, man?
Yeah, I think one thing that a lot of people don't like when I say this, but the listing price is just the number. That does not mean that it's going to sell for that price. And I know that that's really hard to wrap your head around. Think of it in this current market, it's definitely a seller's market. We've had the lowest inventory coupled with the lowest interest rates we've ever had. So you're still not at a full disadvantage at that point, especially if you're on a fixed rate mortgage. But when it comes to that, I think that it's really important that you understand the list price is just a number. And if, let's say that you're trying to do a BRRRR deal, you know, you see a house that's for $70,000, it needs $5,000 of work, and it's going to be worth $120,000 afterwards. Well, you could pay up to, you know, blank amount for that house over the asking price, over their list price, and it's still a good deal. So I think that it's really hard for some people to think, I'm paying too much for this property. But if the numbers work, you have to be able to, you got to be willing to put the offer in, put skin in the game. It's really important.
Yeah. I think it's a big thing on just kind of comes back to that question we were asking about, like, you know, the questions that you should be able to answer is, what is your price point? Do you really know your numbers and things like that? I get caught in that game all the time, you know, buying properties of just like, oh man, I feel like I overpaid for this. Did I really overpay because I know what I maybe could have got it for, or do I still like the deal? If it's exactly your price and it's still a good deal, that's all that really matters. It's oh man, this wholesaler made $10,000 on me. Well, it's okay. I like the price I got it at. It's a good deal. It's a, exactly. Oh, wait, I had to pay this commission on it. No, it's still right. It fits in with what I need to and stuff. So,
A win-win scenario is always, you know, always an advantageous, even if somebody's winning a little more than you, if you're still winning, you're still winning. So,
yeah. Do you have any advice for, you know, when you talk about a little bit of people that are, you know, looking for the local lenders or people to, you know, that are basically can lend on properties, whether they're flip properties, buy and holds, or anything like that, if they're out of state and they're looking for that here in Indianapolis, do you have any advice on, you know, kind of like where to go, how to like develop those relationships, how to work with that on that front? I think it'd be really helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, number one, talk to your agent. They're usually pretty in tune with the different lenders that would be, that have good programs for you to buy. Also, really tap into your resources, tap into your network, because there's so many other people that have done different loans that I've never even heard of, or used different lenders that I've never heard of that worked out amazingly. It's kind of like your own version of Yelp for all these different vendors. It's so important because other people's experiences are going to be so helpful for you to know, should I pull the trigger on this lender or this lender, you know, who's got the better rates. And sometimes you can shop around too. So sometimes lenders can be competitive in this market as well.
Yeah. So I want to pick your brain a little bit about this, because you mentioned this, and I know that you have a great heart, and some of the people you work with have a great heart too and stuff. But if you're somebody that you've done some, you know, you've done some deals in Indianapolis and you feel like you're, you know, you're doing pretty well, what are some ways that maybe they could give back to, you know, some of the investors that are maybe just starting off? And you can answer this as like kind of an investor question or even an agent question or however you want to kind of handle that.
So explain what you mean by giving back. Are you talking like giving back to other people that are new to the market, or?
Yeah, I think just like advice wise or information wise, or just kind of like, hey, maybe somebody can learn from my experience because of this and stuff. You know, we talked a little bit about how that is such a great community and how we do like to help each other out and stuff like that. So if I'm somebody that maybe, you know, somebody that you've worked with, they've done, you know, 10 deals, 20 deals or anything like that, or even you working with other investors, what are some, maybe some ways that they could maybe give information out to some of that, but that's some of that person that's like, oh man, I heard about Indianapolis on Bigger Pockets. I'm going to start doing my first deal with it right now. Like how would they help them maybe?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, a lot of my investors are so, they're just so giving with their time, more so than I am, to be honest. So I look up to them a lot in that respect. A lot of times I'll see people that are newer investors reach out on either Bigger Pockets or a Facebook group, and they'll say, hey, I'm new to the market, and I'm looking for advice and help. I think as much as you can iron that out, because if you're very vague, like, hey, I'm looking to invest in Indy, what should I do? That's really vague and it's really hard for people to help you out. But I would say, yeah, ask for help. It's a very helpful community. People are always willing to reach out to you, especially if you have a very specific question. A lot of times I might not even have an answer to a question somebody might have in the Facebook group, or, you know, Bigger Pockets has a way better answer than I could give. So yeah, don't be afraid to ask for help.
Yeah, no, that's great. I think it's really cool. I feel like I've heard this like three times, like just like today, actually this morning on my conversations, of just like with stuff we've done here on the Indie Pod or just like Facebook groups and stuff like that. I'm just like, man, if only we had this 3 years ago when we started off, or like, I wish we had to, you know, all this kind of stuff. Like, yeah, it is easier. And I'm just like, man, where's this going to go next? Or like, how much information can we be actually put out there to help everybody out? It's really cool to see where it's going. I just want to talk to you too, just on what's some other tips that you have for maybe that other person that, other than kind of like, hey, ask for help or reach out or anything, that person that is maybe just starting to look in Indianapolis, or maybe they've done one or two deals and they're looking to grow, what's some information or some tips you have for them on what they can do to like kind of just get their foot in the door a little bit more and really kind of take advantage of what Indy has to offer?
100%. Well, for instance, I had a deal that just sold yesterday, and I had a client of mine that was had a really high offer that was above our asking price. And there was another guy from our investors group that also wrote an offer. And because he had a relationship with the seller was willing to take an offer less than the other one. So he won out over everybody because he had a relationship and he knew that he was a very serious buyer. So with that being said, building relationships, making sure, hey, don't even just tell your agent what you're looking for. Tell other investors, because sometimes a deal might fall apart that they don't, you know, the numbers don't work for them, but they'll pass it off to you. And I've done that multiple times and actually done really, really well for my clients. Actually, a fair amount of deals I've done for investment properties I've bought have been deals that my clients passed up on. So yeah, please utilize your resources, make relationships in the community, and make sure they know what you're looking for. Because if they do, they might see something that doesn't work for them, but could work for, you know, for you. So that's going to be huge.
Yeah. A couple of different things with that, just to talk about. I think number one is, like, if your criteria changes at all, make sure you inform everybody that you have a relationship with. I don't know how many times I've been having that conversation of, like, where I had a property and somebody's like, oh, I mean, I would have liked that one. Like, why didn't you send that to me first or anything? I'm like, you told me you didn't want that. Like, you weren't buying that last year. Like, oh, well, I kind of changed a little bit. Like, why didn't you tell me? And, like, yes, it's on me because I didn't catch up with you. But when we're at this point of, like, where it is so competitive, is like, it's like kind of where I'm used to in my, and I'm sure kind of the same way of, like, where you're touching base with your clients and you're catching up on their criteria and stuff like that. You almost need to be, if you want to set yourself apart, like, you need to go the opposite of, like, hey, I'm going to inform Ryan or I'm going to inform Brian before they reach out to me, because they need to be updated on everything that I'm doing right now or anything I'm interested in. So
absolutely. And one other thing that I've found successful is really analyze the deals, because what you see on the MLS, what you see from wholesalers isn't always 100% the case. And that's not a jab at anybody, but sometimes you might overlook the tax records of the square footage that's in the house. One time recently for a client of mine, I'll just use some simple numbers. They marketed the property as a 3-1 that was 1,500 square feet. After I looked into the pictures, I saw, no, there's way more square footage than that. And there's actually two bathrooms in this. So we found out it was 1,000 more square feet and it was a 4-bedroom, 2-bath instead of a 3-1. So instantly my client got $15,000 in equity right there just by purchasing the property, by really analyzing the deal. I think a lot of people can look at a property and just be like, nope, doesn't fit. But if you really analyze, you have multiple angles of approach, whether you're going to flip it, whether you're going to, you know, burr it, or even buy and hold conventional with normal financing, what we used to do back in the day. There's a lot of great routes that you can go. And I definitely suggest use multiple angles when you're looking at a deal as much as you can.
Yeah. And I think that's so important of having those, you know, even if, and you can have like that one thing of like, hey, this is what I'm going to specialize in. This is what I want to do. And I want to just buy and hold properties. It is, but have that other exit strategy of, is there something else you can do? If something goes wrong, how are you going to, you know, how are you going to dispose of that property? How are you going to get rid of it? At least have something else in your arsenal to do that. I have that conversation all the time with people that are, you know, just starting off with lead generation and marketing and stuff like that. Like, they might have one thing they're doing a lot of and they're focusing on, like, just pick something else just to mix it up a little bit and have something else in there. And I think it's when you're an investor, having that other exit strategy, at least something else to go to when something's going to go wrong. And when it does, you know, being able to have that other thing that you can do. So I think that's great advice. Ryan, before I get you out of here, man, I really appreciate your time. Really appreciate your tips, just the value you brought today and stuff. Is there anything else that we didn't talk about that you just want to throw out there or talk about before we get you out of here?
Yeah, I'm going to think of it right after this is over. off the top of my head, no, there's not anything right away. This has been an absolute pleasure, and just wanted to always be on this podcast. So I'm really excited to be here. So thanks for the opportunity.
Awesome, man. You can come back at any time. So I just have one last little tip that popped into my head is I know you mentioned this before, just like talking to other people and networking and stuff like that. I think it's so important no matter what you're doing in life. And this comes into investing too, but talk about what you want to be doing to anybody that'll listen. So I just, one of the conversations or one of the things I always go back to, I remember just going out and, I went and sat at one of the local breweries and I was having a beer and there were just three other people that sitting there and just stroke up a conversation, talk about what I do, what I want to be doing and things like that. And one of those three people, they were involved in real estate. They had, you know, their brother was an investor needing properties and things like that. So no matter what you're doing in life, especially if you're an investor or whatever it is, talk about it. Talk to anybody that'll listen. Somebody will gravitate towards you. And with real estate, I really do think about one out of three people is involved in real estate in some way. So you can definitely strike up some relationships and networks that way. So awesome stuff. Ryan, if somebody wants to reach out to you and if they want to find more information about what you're doing, what Platt Collective's doing, or just have a question for you, where can they go?
Yeah, absolutely. So you can find me on any social media, Instagram, Facebook are the ones I primarily use. Ryan Elijah Boyd. Is where you'll typically find me on Instagram or Facebook. You can also reach out to me over my email. It's ryan@plattcollective.com. Platt spelled P-L-A-T collective.com. That's where you'll find me and feel free to reach out.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. And if you need anything from me or anything from the Simple team, please reach out. My name is Brian Snyder. So you can reach out to me at brian@simplewholesaling.com. Be more than happy to help you out with anything that you need and hit me up on social media. And with that is all we have for today in the Indy Investor Pod, and we will see you guys next time. Take care.